All right, well, thank you so much for being here. You look great.
I feel right at home with all the technical problems.
We might need your help later. So I hope we can start out by you just sharing, you know, how did you find out about your diagnosis? What were your symptoms and what was that whole experience like for you?
Well, so it was late 2019 and first of all, being a morning anchor, I get up around 2. And at the time I was also emceeing the Indiana Pacers games. And so, especially if we went into overtime, had a 4-year-old son, and it's hard to tell how fatigued you are when you're doing all that. I didn't realize that my level of fatigue was way more than it should have been. So I had that. I was having just severe lower abdominal cramps and then pressure in my tailbone. And it would come for like 3 or 4 days at a time. So much so I couldn't even work because I couldn't sit down, couldn't lay down. Some different stuff like that. And I start going, and of course they're telling me, oh, colitis, IBS, and I need a colonoscopy. COVID hits, so it gets canceled 3 times. And thankfully I had a doctor, a family doctor, who just kept pushing for it. And randomly a colorectal cancer surgeon says, oh, well, I can squeeze her in. Not thinking at all that it's cancer. And I go in for the colonoscopy, my husband can't come in because of COVID. And at the end of the colonoscopy, when you're kind of waking up, and I heard him say something about a biopsy, and the nurse covered my ears like that and said she's awake. I thought, oh, okay. So go back in the recovery room and I'm saying, oh, it's colitis, right? And, they're saying, oh, you need to talk to the doctor. So they call my husband. He's not expecting to hear that, so he doesn't remember anything. And I get wheeled down and I'm in the truck and I hear him and the nurse talking, and the nurse says something about the tumor. And I leaned out the car window. I said, do I have cancer? And she basically said yes. She did, She didn't, but she did.
So at the time, did you know what colorectal cancer was? Because we hear from a lot of our young patients that some of them don't know what colorectal cancer is, or they think it only can happen in old people. Were you aware that this could happen in young people and what it even was?
The only reason I was is because my husband was an IndyCar crew chief for 13 years, and I used to announce for IndyCar. And John Andretti had just passed away from it, and he was fairly young. And so I was somewhat familiar with it, but it doesn't run in my family. Just kidney and lung cancer in the family. And I did the genetic testing, nothing came back. And, you look at the things you expect, they say obese and stuff like this. And so it was just a total shock. I knew a little bit about it, but never thought it would be my story.
And a lot of people report to us that their symptoms are dismissed for a long time by the medical community, who may not be aware that young onset colorectal cancer is rising. And they often have a long period of symptoms before being correctly diagnosed. Do you have advice for people who, because it sounds like your doctors were pretty responsive and proactive for you, but do you have advice for others who may be in that situation for how to advocate for themselves?
Well, the first thing I did when I got diagnosed, because I didn't want to tell the viewers yet, didn't want to tell the public. And what I actually found, I don't know about a lot of you, but the hardest part for me being diagnosed, one of them was telling me. It's very difficult to tell people for some reason, something you don't expect. So I got on Instagram, I just searched hashtags of colon cancer, young, whatever. And I found, 15, 20 people about my age and looked to them for support. And one of them I really ended up getting close with. We never met in person, but exchanged phone numbers, texted every day for a few years. And she was a mom of 3 and dismissed for 5 years. 5 years. And by that point, it's just kind of too late. And my advice would be, you've got to do what you need to do for yourself. Go to another doctor if you have to. It doesn't matter if you offend them, because it's your life. And also trust yourself about your body. If you if you think something and you're probably right, and why not check it out? So I would just say, do what you need to do to save yourself and help your family.
It's great advice. I think it is good advice that you know your body best, right?
Well, and you know, there are parts where I wanted to get second opinions, and I felt so bad. I didn't want to, because I love my oncologist, I didn't want to offend them. And I just talked to them about it, and then I realized, you know, doctors are not offended when you go somewhere else. In fact, he was like, I would love to know what they say. So don't be scared to do that.
Yep. And I want to reiterate that, you know, all of us are very open to second opinions. We support our patients to do that. It's often really helpful for everybody on the team. So I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
So then you get the diagnosis, and how did it impact your family? How did you end up telling, you know, your child and your family and friends?
Well, Lachlan was 4 at the time. It's kind of hard for me to remember what we did, but, you know, we didn't hide it at all, but we weren't like, oh, now you might die, you know? I started on Zolota right away and radiation. I got through 15 rounds of that, still working. And last thing I remember, I was standing in the hospital looking in the bathroom mirror, and I looked really pregnant, and I had a bowel blockage. So emergency surgery for that, was in the hospital 27 days. I get out, could never resume radiation or the chemo pills again. Dropped down to 89 pounds. And so then I start getting TPN, through my port 18 hours a day. So this is about, by August, I'm well enough to at least have the tumor removal surgery. So I do that in August. Have an internal bleed right after, go back into surgery that night. Finally able to then do chemo. I was supposed to do 12 rounds. I got through 10, full box. Ring the bell, next day, gallbladder out in the hospital for a week. And finally get back to work. And you know, I just, like I was saying, trust your body. I was just like, something's wrong still. And I kept saying, I didn't even think to my mom. So in the ER one weekend, big surprise. And this doctor I've never even met comes out. He said, you know that spot on your lungs grown? I said, oh, well, what spot?
And so you hadn't known about it.
No. So then I was stage 4 and had a lobectomy, left lung. Did that. And then it was a decision, okay, do I do chemo or not after that? And that's actually when I wanted to go get second opinions, because I did not want to do it. And my oncologist thought I should, but the Mayo oncologist didn't, the IU oncologist didn't. And I really didn't want to, and so I finally just said, I really don't want to. And he was cool about it, like preemptively worried. And so I didn't. Then after that is when kind of like you go, what just happened? And then that's when the mental issues start, and then that's when you're trying to learn how to live because you did live and everything's different. And it's like when you get it, the whole family does.
That's totally true. And as you were going through all this, how did you balance work and family responsibilities during that time? I imagine a lot of people here are struggling with the same challenges.
Well, for a part of it, I just couldn't work. I just couldn't. Also, my job, though, I have to, get ready, and present myself and act like everything's fine and smile and all this. And I mean, as many of you know, I mean, you just can't. And I couldn't work. And what I had to learn to do was just let people do stuff. People mowed our grass, do the meal train, take all the help you can get. And it's funny when you get diagnosed who just shows up, people you just didn't expect. With that, I was just so sick. It was just everybody else helping us. So
I'm so glad you were able to get off through all that. You know, there is a stigma around this diagnosis and some of the symptoms associated within it. You obviously have a very public persona. And how did you, were you always wanting to publicize and share your story widely with the public, or was that a decision that was hard to come by?
I never thought twice about saying that I have it. Never even occurred to me. And afterwards, when I started getting messages from people saying, wow, I would have never said that. Or, you know, I'm private about mine. I don't tell anyone. I didn't expect that. And I was surprised how many people, you know, keep it private. And obviously there was a lot I didn't say, but I was, you know, very open about it. And it's funny because I was the news anchor, like I would not even say the word poo. Like I don't think that's serious. And I was like always on fire.
And what was the reaction in the reception to you for sharing your story?
Very good. Very. Everything positive. And that's when I could tell I was getting better, when I started getting reviewer messages again. You need a haircut.
Right. And what do you think are the key important strategies to get that message across clearly to people? Like, are there certain tips or ways of messaging this that you had found to be particularly effective?
Like as far as telling them about it?
Yes, and raising awareness and educating the public.
A lot of people are scared to have colonoscopies.
Yes.
Where the actual colonoscopy is not bad. It's like the night before. Yeah. And even before GI surgeries and stuff. I mean, my main thing is this cancer, at least from what I understand, is if you get in there early and get the polyps out, you're good to go. So I just tell people, just do it, you know, then you won't have to do all of this. I'm also very open about mental health and how difficult that is. I would say just, you know, just be yourself in your own personality and only say what you're comfortable with. Right. Yeah.
And in terms of treatment, any side effects that you went through and have recommendations and advice for people who may be going through the same types of treatment?
Well, I wore those nausea bands all the time. Constantly had the little, you know, things you roll on yourself for nausea and headaches, heating pads everywhere. Gosh, I mean, that's hard to even, you know, remember what you do, because you do about anything you can. Oh, here's a great piece of advice. Get a bidet. Honestly, it's to the point, you know. You know, that to help. And just constantly being in touch with my doctors and asking for help, not just laying there going, oh, what should I do? I was constantly asking for help.
Great advice. And, you know, one question we're wondering is, how were you able to get up so early in the morning? Because you think you're nice to go back to work, right? And while you were on treatment and in and out of the hospital and recovering physically, how were you able to still anchor the morning news?
Well, when I first went back, I only did an hour. And then after like 3 or 4 weeks, I built up to 2 hours and then got back up to my normal 3. And now I could do 5 or 6. But it was just a very slow process. And I also, you know, I don't get upset at myself for anything anymore. If I can't do it, I just don't get that upset about stuff. And maybe even too far one way, you know, it's not life or death. And I would also go home and I would sleep all day. And I still try and go to bed like 6:30 or 7. And so I was able to work, but that's about all I was able to do. And then just kind of slowly build stuff up. These people who are able to work the whole time, they're just unbelievable. It's like Yeah.
And so is this new perspective about if you can't do it, you know, I'm not going to do it, is that different from how you were pre-diagnosis?
I was always pretty laid back. But now it's just, I don't know, you know, having friends that have passed, and I just, even if it's a stressful moment, I tend to think like, well, gosh, I mean, Nikki would have been given anything to have this be a problem, you know? And I think back to where I couldn't even brush my teeth. I mean, I probably didn't shower for more than a month, you know? I didn't wash my hair for 3-4 months, you know? And all I wanted to do at that time was just, gosh, if I could just be a normal, get up and drink coffee. You know, and I think back to where I just wanted to do the simplest things. And there's a time when you're first diagnosed, but I mean, at least for me, I would look at anyone. And as long as they didn't have cancer, I didn't care their situation, I would have ever been them. You know, and it's also now, you know, survivor's guilt becomes a real thing. And the fear that you're going to get it again. I'm a little bit coming out of that now. That was very overwhelming for a long time. I see two therapists. Yeah, I laughed when she said about height because we were over Zoom and I met her and she was like 4'9".
Yeah, I think the mental health support throughout this is really important, and also having somebody who knows what a young person is going through as they have this diagnosis is very important.
One more thing about that. I found acupuncture was huge for my side effects. I forgot about that. I went once a week, big difference.
What was it most helpful for?
Nausea and just anxiety.
Yeah.
I found.
Yeah, so for those of you who are maybe interested in things like that, we do have a Young Center for Integrative Therapies here. So there'll be information about that as someone you can ask questions to about that. Because I do think acupuncture does help a lot of people.
Yeah.
Good. And then, you know, a lot of a big issue that a lot of the young patients go through, especially with rectal cancer who get radiation and chemotherapy and surgery, is the impact on fertility and your family planning. What was that like for you, and was it addressed prior to treatment?
We were probably only planning to have one, so that wasn't huge for us, you know, until afterwards. And I'm like, oh, no, I want a second. So no, that one's over.
Okay, so you did, no one counseled you that the radiation would...
Well, they said, you know, you'll probably go into menopause, but then it's never mentioned again. It's, you know, I know you have a thing on sex health coming up. Yes. That's never talked about. There was no heads up about any of that.
Which is something that hopefully our center will is trying to address better for so many patients. And then, you know, one of my other questions for you is you mentioned COVID and how it maybe led to some delays in you getting your colonoscopy. There has been data out there that a lot of people are not getting their screenings due to COVID. Have you been trying to raise awareness through your platform about, you know, not letting the pandemic delay cancer screening?
Yeah. In fact, I had a doctor on a couple days ago. Well, because those new stats came out. And yeah, we talked about that. It's someone recently told me that there's this pushback still quite a bit. Why? No.
Yes, I think a lot of people are delaying their colonoscopies. Some people are getting stool tests at home rather than doing colonoscopies, which is still good. Any screening is better than no screening.
Well, I know a girl who found it that way.
So yes. So it's good to know that there are lots of options.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, good. What else didn't I cover that you would like to share?
I guess one thing I'd like to say is just, you know, caregivers just don't get enough, you know, attention. It's, I mean, he couldn't work, you know, for quite a bit of it, and did everything, literally everything, even carrying me to the vehicle, literally everything, you know. And even still now, and it doesn't just affect the patient, it's the caregiver so much so. And I thought it was interesting about the, you know, about being able to help kids with young onset. Even before, I didn't really know what to say to them. Mm-hmm. You know, and even now being seven, it's even more so a little difficult. As far as he remembers, he said, oh, one day you were doing yoga and then you were sick. Mm-hmm. This is kind of how he sees it. I don't remember doing yoga ever. I Yeah, I guess the caregiver thing, you know, that, and I think I also forgot to say I did have blood in the stool as a symptom, and that was kind of the final straw. Because when the whole fatigue thing, you know, Chris and I, we just never really argued that much. He's, you're more tired than you should be. And I got really offended. You know, I'm like, I'm gonna do this, not knowing I was very, very tired. And so I guess one other piece of advice I would have is to, like, if other people are telling you stuff, like, they might be right.
You know, to listen to others around you who know you. Yeah. Now with your son, did you use the word cancer? I know. Okay. And how was his reaction?
And then, not that it worked out nicely, but then when he got to school, he has a little girl in his class with him. And so we talked to him about, you're able to be a good friend to her, you know? And so it ended up kind of being nice, but not nice, you know?
Yeah. I think you bring up such a good point about caregivers, right? They are often overlooked in all of this, and they play such a huge role in helping their loved ones get through this, and there aren't very many supports for them. We have been trying to start caregiver support groups and have educational webinars for caregivers, and we have a special caregiver session today as well. So hopefully that will help a lot of the supporters in the room.
The patient gets all the attention, and then, you know, in my job, it was also a lot of public attention. And so Chris really didn't get that much help. And also with guys, it's not like his guy friends are, you know, texting, like, it's just not, and we still kind of deal with some issues like that. I feel like I'm always the sick one. I was in the hospital for a month ago. It just never ends. And, you know, he's been sick in the last week, and I was feeling weird and I didn't want to say anything because I just feel like it's always about me, you know, and there's just so much with cancer that comes with it besides chemo and radiation. And that I would imagine is going to last my whole life.
And a lot of people report that as they transition to survivorship, finishing treatment, that might be the hardest time. You're always dealing with that uncertainty of what's next and what's coming up with the next scan. Do you have any coping strategies or helpful tips that you might want to share with the people in the room for how you cope with that?
Well, I didn't really struggle with depression or anxiety before cancer. And so I just think you have to acknowledge that you have it. How could you not? You know, I mean, and so I didn't want to do group therapy. I just didn't want to. And so I just asked the hospital, and I wanted to go to a female, and I said, you know, can I have a list of, and they just gave me a list of women doctors, you know, deal with people with cancer. And I end up with two therapists. And I don't tell each about the other. So it's all Zoom. It gets to where you can go see them in person. And I kid you not, they share a parking lot. Also, it really helped me, like I said, when I went on social media, I just found people in similar situations as me. And you know, when you're in the depths of treatment, you need people you can ask about these symptoms and going to the bathroom and stuff like that. It's really helpful to ask people what they've done. Just find people that get help, any books, lots of sleep. Fact is, it's just really hard. And some days are great, and some days I cry all day. You don't know why still, you know, it's just kind of got to, I don't know, but you say figure it out, but it's hard to. I wish I could give better advice on that, but I don't feel like I'm fully, you know, healed from it.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's something you constantly have to write.
Yeah. Because I met a girl in the chemo room, Jesse, and we became friends. And then, you know, I had the girl, Nikki, that I was friends with, and they died a week apart. And, you know, so even as you're going, just things happen and things come back. And it's probably, I would imagine, just a constant working on yourself.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your story.